Welcome, friends, on this third and final day and final session of our three-day event here in Newport Beach. Once again, I'm very happy to see all of you. And I enjoyed my 3 days spending time with you, talking to you from the stage as well as the personal time I had in personal interviews with many of you. In the personal interviews, I got a lot of feedback how effective meditation has been helping transform your lives and how many changes have taken place in your life because of meditation. Makes me feel very happy that what my experience with meditation has been, your experience is the same. If we give more time to meditation, we get more experiences. So keep this in mind, that when we decide what we have to do in life, we have to survive, we have to work, we have to have a lot of social and other obligations. We have to fulfill all of them. Spiritual path does not mean that you give up your duties and your obligations in life and run away to some forest to meditate. The real spiritual path is to perform your duties as efficiently, as skillfully as you can, and consider that as part of meditation. Again, some people who like to hear about Lord Krishna teachings, I will give you a quote. He says, yoga karma su kaushalam. True yoga is doing your every duty, every work with the utmost skill you have. You become a karma yogi. If you can do all your work with utmost skill and think it's part of your meditation. What makes action into meditation is whether you are thinking of your master, thinking of the divine, thinking of God. If you are thinking of that while doing worldly duties, it's meditation. So that is why you can make your whole life into meditation. So this is a lifestyle of living a spiritual path. It's not merely giving a few minutes or 1 hour or 2 hours or 5 hours to meditation. Everything should be meditation. Great Master was asked, how much should we do meditation? He said, what do you think? He said, we were told at initiation we should try to do 1/10 of the time, 2.5 hours. He said, have you ever seen a balance on which we put weight on one side and the product produced that we are measuring on the other side? If you put 1/10 weight, and which way will the balance go? If you're doing 2.5 hours meditation, spending 23.5 hours on other things, how will meditation work? They said, Master, then how much should we do? He said, ideally, you should do 23.5 hour meditation and 2.5 hour for other intellectual work where your attention is needed elsewhere. Master, how can we do? We have to sleep, we have to work, we have to eat, we have to cook, we have to do so many things, our jobs. Well, everything can be made into meditation. If you do your simran, repetition of the words, mentally, not with the tongue, if you do it with your mind, mind makes it a habit. And you will see that if you are practicing meditation by repeating words in your mind, the mind makes it a habit, and any time you can just check in, the mind is repeating the words. When that happens, even when you sleep, all night the mind is repeating the words. If you suddenly wake up at night, you'll see the mind is repeating the words. Without your trying to do it, the mind has a nature of forming habits, and you can also form a habit. So the great master said, that way you could be meditating all night, even when you're sleeping. Then during the day, if you are thinking of your master, remembering him, that's meditating upon the master. Meditating upon the divine. When that happens, your life becomes a meditation. He said, I allow for 2.5 hours for other work because sometimes people do come across serious problems or serious issues on which they have to give time. And he says, normally that's not more than 1/10 of your time. So 2.5 hours for other work and 23.5 hours for meditation. The whole point is, what is our priority in life? If you put the spiritual path, the meditation, at the top of your priority. No matter what, we have to start the day from there. Your whole day will be much better. You can check it out. If you say, I'll start tomorrow, I'll do it on the weekend, it weakens the whole effort. I have often told people that if you want to meditate, do it regularly. If you do it in large hours, number of hours every weekend, is not the same thing as doing even 10 minutes every day. There's a momentum we create. In everything we do, there's a momentum we can create. If we do it regularly, at the same time, every day, a momentum is created. It automatically reminds us meditation time. And we do it, and it builds up. Every day it builds up more. That is why if you have enough time, do more. If you have less time, do less, but do it regularly, every day. Make it your priority, you'll get the best results. So this is just a tip I'm giving, that make it more regular than merely saying, I was able to give 3 hours on Sundays, and that's the only day I meditate. That's not as effective as doing 5 minutes every day. So just a point I was making. Some people have a problem following the vegetarian diet. I mentioned yesterday that the vegetarian diet helps us to concentrate our attention better and makes meditation more effective. We tested it out. You can test it also. If you are not a vegetarian, become vegetarian for a month and see if meditation improves. There is nothing like proof of the pudding lies in the eating. There is nothing more convincing than your own experience. And I explained to you how it is important. Now, I was very happy to see amongst you many followers of John Roger, who passed away in 2014. But he was giving teachings, mainly in the Hollywood area, giving teachings based upon the teachings of Great Master. He got visions of Great Master and followed his teachings from the inner visions he was getting. And in his bedroom I saw, there was only a picture of Great Master, Baba Sawan Singh. He had never been to India, never seen him. But his teachings were the same. And how I got to know them is a strange coincidence, very strange. John Roger died in 2014. In 2015, a year later, an associate, a disciple of his, Jan Shepherd, was typing out a memorial talk that is to be given on his anniversary of his passing away. When she was typing on the computer, a picture suddenly appeared by accident. She says, by accident, sometimes computers, you know, make some mistake. By accident, a picture appeared, and the picture was of one Ishwar Puri. He didn't know who he was, or why did a picture come? When she saw at the bottom of the picture, disciple of Great Master Baba Sawan Singh, she said, John Roger has sent this picture. And they contacted me, and I was able to go and meet all of them. It's a pure accident, pure coincidence. And now I'm very happy so many of them are here and have been attending this meeting. But John Roger had modified the teaching because he said, in this country, it's very difficult to have a vegetarian diet. So the followers were not following the vegetarian diet. And I explained to them how vegetarian diet will improve the meditation. Now, they want to change from non-vegetarian to vegetarian. And they say, where is vegetarian food available? We have been eating meat to get our protein to get this thing. So today I want to introduce to you a friend of mine who works on producing meat substitutes that look and taste like meat, but they are plant-based, they are vegetarian. A lot of other stuff has also come in this. In 1960, I was studying this, how to make meat substitutes. In 1970, I got a United Nations fellowship to work on surplus soya bean, soya protein available in this country, United States. And they wanted to see if this heavily high protein in soybean could be used into a human food. Till that time, since 1970, in this United States, it was used only as animal feed. So it was a big challenge to make a feed into food, animal feed into human food. The United Nations Children's Fund selected some people, a couple of us, I was one of them, to see how this can be done. So I experimented on soy protein, and I found out that there are some things in the soybean, in the inner lining of the soybean, called trypsin inhibitor. The trypsin inhibitor was inhibiting the absorption of protein when it was given to the third world countries. We took the surplus soybean, they used to have big bean bowls over here. I examined all of them, I traveled all over the world on that fellowship. And I worked hard on this to make something from vegetable protein into a meat substitute. And then I found through extrusion methods, to heat and pressure, we can convert them almost like meat of different types. My friend who's here right today, and his son is here, they're both working on the project for which I first came to this country. I came to this country to develop meat substitutes so that people can become vegetarian very easily without saying, oh, we have no taste for this grass we are eating and we want to eat some real food. I said, we can make real food from grass also. So real food was made, and now we have products that are like meat. You can have plant-based chicken, plant-based beef, plant-based lamb, plant-based everything. And they are plant-based fish. So people have an easy way to convert without feeling that we are missing out on taste or missing out on protein or missing out on nutrients. In fact, the nutrients in these substitutes that I have been developing, and I worked with this company for a while, and as a consultant and as a part of the company. So I am just pointing out that you have a possibility of getting these substitutes. So those who have had a difficult time in conversion, we have food, plant-based food available. If you want to get more information about this, I will request the gentleman, if he is here, father and son, please, are you here, Dr. Brinson and JR? Where are they?
Yes, we're here.
You are here. There are these gentlemen from Chicago. And they are, you can contact them if you like and get more information afterwards. Thank you very much. And if you have any samples with you or something and anybody is interested, can they contact you?
Yes.
Okay, very good. Thank you. Thank you very much. Now, having said that, I still feel that you should see the effect of diet. But diet, becoming vegetarian is not enough. How much you eat is also important. If you eat heavy meals, they also do not allow you to meditate properly. So not only I am suggesting vegetarian food, I am suggesting light food. Make it as light as possible. You know, in this country, over the last 20 years, obesity has grown every year, especially juvenile obesity in children. Just because the food they are eating is either not the best healthy food, or they are overeating, and people think overeating is good. There's a very good reason why people overeat. And that is, in the body, normally the nervous system sends information to the brain very quickly. So far as hunger and digestive system is concerned, those messages don't go through the normal nervous system. They go through the bacteria in the gut. More and more discoveries being made about the importance of the bacteria. Do you know there are trillions of bacteria sitting inside each of us? The average weight of bacteria in our body is about 3 pounds on an average adult. It's supposed to be the largest organ of the body, heavier than the liver, the stomach, and the heart combined. It's heavier than that. It's so important. Those bacteria are good and bad bacteria both sitting together. The bad bacteria like junk food. They like food that is not the best for us. The good bacteria like good food. And therefore, the messages are going from there. And they have a tendency to delay the message when we are full. All other messages from the nervous system go instantly to the brain. When you are full and no longer hungry, this message takes 20 minutes to go to the brain. It's amazing how the difference has been kept. All overeating is done in those 20 minutes. Because you discover 20 minutes later, after you're full, that you are full. The message is delayed. I went to Japan and found they have a different way of eating. They divide their food into portions. When it comes to the last portions, they allow 20 minutes gaps. So by that time, they know they are full. They won't overeat. So that's a very good system. Here also, if you feel you are still hungry, allow 20 minutes to pass, you'll be hungry. You'll be full. No, not hungry anymore. So that is why we overeat. If you eat, let me give you a challenge. Cut down what you're eating by 25%, you'll be more healthy. Simple. It's such a straightforward statement. If you cut down half what you're eating, you'll still be healthy. We overeat so much. The body does not need that much. People laden with proteins are worrying about protein. You can't imagine how much we are overdoing protein over here. Just somewhere the idea has gone. Where do I get my protein from? Protein is the building block which raises children, makes them adults, and makes them big. Maintenance of a body does not require that protein. And we are eating more protein as grown-ups than we feed even the children. So that is why we are not having a balanced diet. And look at the diet we are having. Overeating also interferes in meditation the way meat eating does. Therefore, it's not merely being vegetarian. It's also eat light meals. The other important thing is the timing when you eat. Meditation is recommended early morning and before going to sleep. It's a good timing. Then do a bulk of your meditation in the morning when you rise and do a little bit at night before you sleep. If you do in the morning, the whole day goes in meditation. If you do at night, the whole sleep is with meditation. It's a good timing. Of course, if your jobs are such that these are not the right timing, you can change time. There is no fixed time at which the Lord is listening more and at other times he shut his ears. He open ear all the time for prayer and meditation. All times are equally good. But if you do, suppose you have to do 2.5 hours. You can do 2 hours in the morning, half an hour at night. Supposing you want to do 1 hour, half an hour in the morning, half an hour at night. Supposing you want to do 5 minutes, 5 minutes in the morning, 5 minutes at night. But these are two times when it's most effective. Since you do meditation at night also, the dinner should be much lighter than is being taken now. So the evening meal should be lighter, and that will make a difference in your meditation. And I am telling you these things not from books. I'm telling you from my own personal experience, my personal. I was very overweight. I became very fat one time. I was overeating because in India, if you visit somebody, they think it's a necessary hospitality to offer you something to eat. So if I visit 3 places, I eat 3 dinners. So, and somehow, this tradition was brought by some of my friends from United States who went to India, and they started doing the same thing here. So I was overeating. Now, I can't say no to them, but I can try to make the portion as small as possible. So I was able to control some of my overeating by that. Made a difference in meditation. What I am telling you is not based upon 1 or 2 years experience, it's over a whole lifespan. When you turn over, when you're older than 90 years, you're not looking at a great time ahead, you're looking back. How did you pass these 90 years? You pass through ups and downs, you pass through many kind of phases. So it's by recollection I can tell you how these things helped me. And I'm sharing these, they might help you also. So these are some of the important things about diet, eating less. Also, I read, somebody sent me a nice quote from some saint saying, the most important enlightenment comes when you feel you are calm. And I realized that what he meant by calmness is that you don't get provoked into anger. You are not disturbed by anything. It is a great thing to be calm. And we can all practice to be calm. In the beginning, we are provoked. Most provocations lead to a retort in anger. And anger, what anger does it, it spreads our attention wide. If you can see your attention, suppose you say, my attention has a color. And when I get angry, I can see, where is my attention? It just scatters like this around you. If you are too lustful, the attention goes down. Different effects, different effects on the attention. And if you can watch, you'll see how the attention scatters. If you have a very angry episode, attention is scattered, and then you say, I'm going to do meditation. You can't meditate properly. It's hard, much harder. You scattered your attention already. Meditation is all a game of concentrating attention. That's what it's all. There is one short way of describing meditation, concentrating your attention upon the self. If attention is more scattered, it becomes more difficult. I stayed in the house of one friend of mine who was a satsangi, also great master disciple. And when he thought he was going to meditate, if his wife happened to say, darling, it's time for dinner, he'd get so angry, shouted, don't you realize I'm doing meditation? What kind of meditation is that? I mean, you are expressing your desire to do meditation with so much anger, the two are contradictions. So that is why it's not merely food. It's not merely how much you eat. It also what mood you are in. The best meditation takes place when you are calm and cool. I realized the word cool, what it means. I didn't know. I thought it means cold. When I came to this country, I gave a talk to some friends, and somebody said, I liked your talk. He said, why? It was cool. I said, what does the hell mean? I thought it wasn't cold. But calm and cool, now I understand it. Best state to be in for effective meditation. There are so many factors that help us to improve our meditation. So that is why it's not merely following some ritual. It's not merely fixing a time to meditate. It's not merely what you eat is going to give good meditation. All these factors combine to make effective meditation. These so-called 5 vices, they describe them as vices, vicious things that we do. Anger, lust, greed, possessiveness, ego, haughtiness. They describe these as our enemies. If we didn't have these, nobody could pay off their karma at all. These are essential things for paying off our karma. The karma creating and paying off is based on the use of these 5. So we can't say they are all enemies. These are tools to be used for paying off our karma. And they come automatically to pay off the karma. We don't say, now I'm going to use my anger to do this. Now I'm going to use my lust to do this. It automatically happens. Karma is played out like that automatically. But when you are on a spiritual path, these things can become a distraction to your inner journey, inner progress. So in course of time, you have to lighten the burden of these five on your own attention so that you can withdraw faster. A stage comes in meditation when they drop off automatically. That stage comes when you cross the mind. The moment your attention has been able to reach a point where you realize you are the soul, mind was merely an instrument to think. When you reach that point in actual realization, in meditation, you find you don't get angry after that. There's no lustful thing. There's no greed left. There's no possessiveness left. There's no ego left. It's an amazing thing that these things have been built for our stay in the three worlds of mind. Physical, astral, causal. That's where they operate. They don't operate anywhere else. So that is why they ultimately go away like that. In some books, to make it look like a physical thing, this departure of the five vices, they show that a crow gets into the great lake of Mansarovar and then comes out like a swan. And all these five vices look like little boys and they walk away. So sometimes in our own idiom, in the Dera India, we used to say, have the five boys left you or not? It meant that. How I remember it is that if I told you the story of a man who had come to Dera claiming that he goes to Parbrahm, he was just a visitor to the Dera, but he would sit on a platform after great master's discourse. He would gather his own people, that he was also like a saint giving talks. And I realized it is all his ego. I was a young child, but I didn't like what he was doing. So I had one day with my handkerchief, a safety pin, you know. I just tied up for something, I had to tie up something. I opened the safety pin. And when he was saying, he is in Parbrahm, I went behind him and poked him in the butt. He got so angry. He got up and ran after me. I could run faster, I knew. So I couldn't catch up. But I remember shouting back at him, where are your five boys? I still remember that. But he was showing such much anger that people all laughed and walked away after seeing his state. And if you are actually at that level, you can't even be provoked into anger. You can't even be, you just laugh and smile, and say, yes, what is this game? What is this? Something else. So, but what can happen before that? Supposing we are aware that at a certain level of enlightenment, these five boys will run. What can we do now? What we can do now is to be conscious of them. To be conscious of them and try not to make them part of your actual action, which means you're angry, hold it back. I asked somebody an easy way, how can we hold back anger? He said, make a decision every time you're angry, count up to 100 and you won't be angry. It works. It only needs a little time gap. So if you can hold back and see, why am I angry? Is this a karma I'm paying off? Then I've got angry in my head. Do I have to react to what is causing the anger? Remember, in karma, if something provokes you to anger, and you get angry and retort and react to it, you create new karma. If you don't, and digest it inside as a payoff, it becomes a payoff, karma ends there. If you don't react to these provocations, karma ends. And if you react, you create a new one. And it goes on and on like that. So most of us react to karma, react to provocation in different ways. And that is why the cycle of karma keeps on going on. So it's best to practice restraint and see how much we can hold and argue to ourselves, remind ourselves, this is the payback from the past. And therefore, if I react, I also get angry, somebody is angry with me. If I get angry, I am perpetuating the karma. If I don't, I am finishing it. Good way to cut down your karma. Somebody had asked me a question by email, and somebody had asked personally also, that I have said in my talks that when a perfect living master initiates a disciple, the sinchit karma is washed away, erased right at that time. And the only karma left is the prarabdha, the destiny with which you are born here. Yet, in some books they say, they read that some of the karma is taken care of in the astral and causal planes. If the sinchit is completely erased, what karma is being taken care of in the astral and causal planes? So I wanted to explain that if a perfect living master initiates a disciple, the reserve karma is wiped off completely. And it cannot be used for any future life or anywhere else. But the current karma, which is the destiny you come with, is still to be fulfilled. And while you are making sure this karma is paid off in this one lifetime, you are creating new karma also. Supposing you don't have to come back in second life, and the remainder of your life you have been creating more karma, that's the one that is paid off in the astral and causal states. It's not sinchit karma that's paid off there. It's the remainder of the newly created karma that you are creating in the balance of your life after initiation. That is why it's a good idea that after initiation, practice more restraint and remind yourself, if I'm going to do this, it will perpetuate the karma, it will prolong, I'll have to work it out in the astral plane. Some people say, we don't want to waste time in astral plane. Then don't create the kind of karma that if you're not coming here, you have to pay it off in the astral plane. Some people ask me, is it possible that we don't go into astral and causal planes at all? Can a perfectly living master take us directly? I said, of course. Just be a little careful of your karma, and great master or perfect living master will make sure that any little karma you create, in spite of your restraints, is paid off in the remainder of the life itself, not later on. Sometimes people say, my karma seems to have increased. It's increased because you are not going to pay off in the astral stage, nor do you want to come back. When you want both things, not coming back again and not waiting on the way to pay off, then masters themselves help that you pay off whatever you're doing now, pay off right in the remainder of your life. So this is sometimes called accelerated payoff of the karma. Karma is in the hands of a master after initiation. A master sees what's the best for that particular disciple. And that is why I'm just explaining how it works. I'm just explaining that it's a good thing for us after initiation not to create more karma. Karma is created by the way we think and have our intentions to do things. Put your attention in more meditation. Put your attention more love and devotion as much as possible. People could provoke you. Don't get provoked. Thank God. Say, thank you. I paid off. Somebody attacks me, I say, thank you, it's very good. It's useful for me that you attacked me, it's paid off. I must have attacked you in the past, otherwise you won't do it. It's sudden, it's not premeditated. And if you are creating a second person is creating a karma by intentionally doing something, you don't react to create more for yourself. That is why a life of restraint till your attention can go beyond the mind would be very helpful, and it does help. Now, I am saying these things you haven't experienced, some of you have, now most of you haven't experienced, that what I am talking, is it verifiable? Yes, it is, by all of you. Again, meditation. Meditation with love and devotion draws your attention inside, and what I am talking of is visible there. You can yourself see how karma operates. You go to the causal stage, the whole secret of karma is revealed to you. Everything I have shared with you, you can watch yourself and see it's there, how it is being done. How we pay off our karma in astral planes, also there. We cannot create karma in the astral plane. We cannot create karma in the causal plane. Certainly we can create no karma because there is no karma in the spiritual regions. The only place we create karma is the physical plane. Payoff can take place in so many forms. Payoff can take place in different forms of life. You could stay in a forest for a tree for 1,000 years. You could become a cat or a dog or an insect or a bird. Paying off karma. No creating of karma. All payoff. And then you can be paying off in, as a human being also. Payoff is available in several ways. Creation only in one way. The physical wakeful state. You can't even create karma in sleep. You can pay off in sleep. People say, I had a very bad accident in my dream. What does it mean? Am I going to have an accident? I said, no, you paid off the accident in a dream. You paid off something that could have happened in life. You're lucky you paid it off in a dream. It was your experience of an accident. Therefore, your experience is what creates payoff of karma. It's your experience what creates karma, your experience that pays off. So karma can be paid off in so many ways and created only now when we are in a wakeful state and have free will and we have to make choices. So make the best choices. There is nothing greater than associating everything that happens around you with the master. It can be done. Everything happens. Master, thank you. Master, why did you do this? It's a bad thing. Master, how did you do this? If you want to get angry, with the master. Meditation. Did you know that? Complaint to the master. Meditation. If you are somehow associating master with every little event and action that happens in your life, you are not creating karma, but putting attention inwards. So that's the easiest way I found. That whether something happens which you think is good or bad. Good, thank you, master. Bad, why did you do it? Simple. It's just remembering master both ways. It's meditation both ways. But you will notice that very often, when you practice reminding yourself, this is a payoff of the old karma. And meditate regularly, you'll be able to see what the payoff was for. Right now, we don't know. We don't see our past lives. But in other levels, you will be able to see the past lives, why we are paying off. Right now, we sometimes don't understand why certain bad things, so-called bad things happen, because we say, we did nothing in this life. Why did this happen? But we forget what we did in the past life. We forget. This forgetfulness is a very important factor. The role of forgetfulness is very important. If you did not have this role, there would be no world existing here. We could not exist if we did not forget the past. It'll be impossible. We'll all be screaming all the time and all die out of screaming if we could not forget what happened in the past. Forgetfulness is helping us. Forgetfulness of the past life makes this life real for us. And everything looks like really happening now. Of course, it perpetuates this creation. But for a seeker of the truth, for a seeker who wants to go beyond, it's important to know that since we have forgotten what happens, we have only to assume that we are paying off and not perpetuate the karma. When you go inside, you will also be able to see, good, I paid off. Supposing you buy some groceries from a store and at the counter you are paying off. Do you ever feel bad about paying off? No, you bought something, you're paying off. You did something, you pay off something. You go to an amusement park, you are having a ride, you buy a ticket. You go to a movie, you buy a ticket. You never say, oh, somebody's stealing my money. But if you didn't know that you're paying for the ride, somebody's stealing your money. In this case, because of forgetfulness of the past, we are thinking, somebody stole my money. No, you stole his money or her money, and you are just paying back, settling an account. All karmic payback is settling of accounts. And don't you want to settle accounts and be done with it? No matter what accounts they are, whether they are here with a grocery store or at the gas station or anywhere, we settle accounts. And there we are settling a karmic account. Just this awareness, keeping this awareness with us till we reach inner stages, is helpful, not creating more karma and not having to come back for a second life just because of the remainder karma even after initiation. So initiation should be a very big turning point in our life. Very often, the love that we experience from a master, especially if we are able to associate more and more with the perfect living master, the love and devotion grows. Automatically, that memory of the love we experience from a master, that holds us, holds our attention, and we do not pay that much attention to things that are happening around. If we don't have that pull of the love, our attention goes immediately to these little things and we react. So the reactions become less automatically when we are experiencing love and devotion for a master. So that's another good reason that meditate all day. Remember master for with everything that you are doing, and karma will not be created and old dues will be paid very quickly. I am sharing these as day-to-day tips that we can use. People ask me, how do we balance our worldly obligations with an obligation to our spiritual side? The word obligation does apply to worldly things. It does not apply to going in. You're not obliged to go in. Nobody forces you to go and find the truth. It's your seeking. To seek something and find is not an obligation. But worldly things are obligations. So you can't compare the two. You can't say, how do I balance the two? I am being pulled inside and pulled outside. That's not it at all. Inside is your seeking. You want something. You desire very strongly. And you are able to get it by a certain practice. Outside is settling of accounts. There is no balancing to be done. Both can be done equally effectively. There is nothing wrong in settling your accounts outside, nothing wrong in paying off your karma, nothing wrong in doing your job well, nothing wrong in bringing up your family with the best of your attention, nothing wrong in taking care of your children as best as you can and still be going inside what you seek. There's no clash really. Some people think there's a clash. It's not really a clash at all. You can do both equally effectively. You can do your worldly duties, worldly obligations, fulfill them. But one thing is there, if you want to be a good follower of the spiritual path, you have to be strong. You can't be weak. You have to be strong. Because to deal with situations, you have to be strong and not be led away by other people, led away by your doubts, led away by fear. When those things come, both sides become weak. You can neither be very effective in this physical world, nor are you effective inside. So be strong. And that strength has to be picked up from somewhere. The best source for picking up strength is from the master. You should see the strength of a master. You should have a look at the master, his life. Look at his strength, look at the way he dealt with things. Automatically we get inspiration to be strong like that. And masters come here to make us like themselves. They make us as strong as they are. That's their objective. That's why they're here. That's why they come in our life. And that is why we have a role model already available to us to see the strength that we can have. If you're strong, you deal with everything with strength. But strength does not mean shouting. Some people think when we shout loud, we are showing our strength. Shouting is weakness. Firmness is strength. If you have to do something and you are firm about it, that is strength. But to shout and then give in, because other person shouted louder, that's not strength. So that is why, save your voice as much as possible. You might notice that we speak too much. I am very guilty. Right now I am conscious of it. And it's a confession that I speak too much. There was a saint named Bhikha. And Bhikha, in his own vernacular language, says, Bhikha baat agam ki kehen sunan mein nahi, jo jane so kahe na, jo kahe so jane nahi. Translated, he says that the knowledge of the unknown cannot be spoken. One who speaks knows not, and one who knows speaks not. So now you know where I stand. But we have to see that we don't speak unnecessarily. Do you know how much our talk is unnecessary? Examine. After you have spoken, was it necessary? Buddha said, before you speak, consider, is it necessary? Is it useful? Is it kind? Then open your mouth. If none of this applies, don't open your mouth. So it's very important that we speak less, hear more. Besides hearing, we should listen more. There's a difference in hearing and listening. When you practice listening more, supposing you want to listen to your friend. You say, come on, tell me your story. Yes, yes, you're busy with something. That's hearing, not listening. Listening is only when you put attention. When you give attention to your friend and listen. The best way to listen to a friend in trouble, whom you want to help. Listening alone will help, hearing will not. Hearing out a friend never helps. Giving attention and listening to your friend who is in trouble, listening as if you are that person, not that you are somebody else and listening to complaint by somebody else. Put yourself in the place of that person who we are listening. That's the best way to give a good attention. Good attention is put yourself in place of the person who you are listening. Do you know your listening will solve that problem in 90% cases? I have tried it. It works. You can try it also. Listening is very important. Now, if we practice listening outside, do you know the advantage? We will listen inside. The quality of listening outside develops the quality of listening inside. And since Shurta Shabda Yoga, the yoga of listening to the sound of your own self inside, involves listening with attention the same way, like listening outside, your daily practice of listening outside will help you in your meditation in listening inside. That's a very useful thing. That is why listening is very important. And speaking should be minimum, listening should be more. And that will help a lot of people if you listen more. It is also important to remember that we have individual karma. Each one of us carries our own karma. When we grow up, we carry our own karma. When a baby is born, a little sweet bundle of joy, you know that. What happens, the sweet bundle of joy is this tall, won't listen to us. And does things which we tell, don't do, but he says, I'll do more. Teenagers, this is a teenager state. Now it's a grown-up state. I know more than my dad. I know better, much better. This is the same baby that we said with bundle of joy. What has happened? Own karma. Twin brothers or twin sisters born. Identical twins sharing the same ova or sperm or whatever it is that makes them identical twins. Grow up totally different. Look identical and they grow up totally different. Totally different nature. Total different attitudes. Karma is very individual. Therefore, remember, because we all have had experience of children growing up, we grew up as children, all of us, and we also now see our children, grandchildren. I see my children growing up, grandchildren growing up, and we try to say they should work in this particular way. They should live their life like this. We are going to guide them how to live. It doesn't work. Karma will work. Everyone is carrying their own karma. Therefore, trying to modify the lives of other people, whether children or adults, is a useless exercise. Don't waste your time on that. Everybody has their own karma, and they all live like that. Another lesson to be learned, because so many times we think that we can modify other people's lives. It doesn't work like that. So that is why there are jokes made about how husbands and wives deal with each other and so on. I read a joke this morning. I want to share with you, because I was once stopped by a cop. It was Christmas Eve. I was coming with my wife from a midnight mass at a church. We go there regularly because the minister there starts his service from John's Gospel. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, the Word was God. I like that. And then that's always the beginning of his sermon, and then he goes on. And I told him, I said, we come for that sermon. And midnight mass. I was going back, a cop stopped me. I said, now I'm going to get a ticket. I should pray. It was a lady cop. She took my driver's license and came back. The holiday spirit has struck me. I'm not giving you a ticket. I said, thank you, Master. But I heard today something different. A guy was speeding and a cop was chasing him. And the guy sped more. He's a good car. He said, I'll not. Then he realized the cop can wire somebody else to stop me from front. What am I trying to do? So he stopped. And the cop came to me and he said, do you know you kept on running fast when I was chasing you with my lights on? Cop said, I have only 10 minutes to be off duty. If you can give me a good excuse why you were running so fast, I'll let you go. Otherwise, you have to get a ticket. And this man said, yes, I have a good excuse. Last year, a cop, my wife ran away with a cop. I thought you were bringing her back. He said, good day, sir. Just sharing experiences. It's just sharing experiences. I'm very happy I spent this time with you sharing personal experiences. I hope some of the things I've said to you will be useful in your lives. I feel very happy. I feel so much like you are part of my family. Can't help it. Can't help feel you are like my children. At my age, I can even call those who have white hair as my children. It's an advantage of an age. There are many advantages of getting old, I discovered. I have a pass. I can travel on a bus at half fare. I have a cane. You see my cane. I walk with a cane. They let me go ahead. So some minor advantages and some major advantages that one can now use the whole life. It has given you so many lessons to learn, and you can share them with friends whom you love. I love you all. Thank you very much for being with me. And we'll have now Prashad. Prashad is an Indian word meaning blessed. Something blessed is we call Prashad. Normally we give Prashad, which is a puffed rice or something, or sometimes Prashad can be something else. My dad, who was the initiate of Great Master, he thought anything touched by Master is Prashad. So we should have everything in our house, Prashad. So Great Master would come to our house. We had a large dining table with 8 chairs. And he would sit at the head. He changed the chair every time. All 8 became Prashad. in the bed sheets we used to spread on his bed every time he made new sheets and kept his old ones. Everything was prasad in the house. And I said, he has given us blessings so many times. Are we not prasad also? Yes, everything is prasad. What is the advantage of prasad? Advantage is when you call it prasad, you remember the master. That's the advantage. Advantage is a good tool, good instrument for remembering the master. Remembering the master is meditation. So that is why prasad helps us. We used to get puffed rice in India and we used to take a little bit at a time. Why? So we could remember him longer. If we could eat all of it at once, then we have nothing to remember afterwards. Also, with master's permission, he told us what to do. If that prasad ran low in quantity, then we could buy the same thing from the store and mix it up and shake it. Shake it so much that we don't know which one was the original, which one is not. All of it reminds of us master. It's all of it becomes prasad. Prasad does not mean that it has changed into something else. Whatever it is, it is. A chair, prasad is chair. Puffed rice is puffed rice. It does not change. It only adds this blessing that when we take it, we remember the master. If it is this blessing, blessing helps us a lot. Blessing pulls our inside upwards into the head and not downwards. When we get blessing, it's in our state of awakening, pulls us up. We always feel we are blessed, which means we are high. Blessing is a very big thing and changes our life sometimes, a blessing alone. So when we have blessed prasad, it means that we are getting blessings with every time we put a little bit in our mouth. The prasad I am going to give, you have puffed rice, right? Okay, I am going to invoke the blessings of my master, great master Baba Sawan Singh. Therefore, it's his blessings you'll be receiving. You can't see him except his photo, but I see him alive as I saw him when he was living. Therefore, is being blessed by the living master from my point of view. From your point of view, I'll be handing it over to you. But it's very specially blessed. Please take little bit at a time and remember the time we spent here. Remember your master and remember that in meditation. Take some before meditation. Meditation will be better. Blessings help in everything. You have a journey to make. Take it for blessing. You have some important work to do, take it for blessing. Blessing is good at every occasion. So make good use of it. And I'm very happy that I was able to get this chance to not only talk to you, but because the number is still limited, not like what we get in Bandara and so on, where we have to now distribute the prasad. I can bless it and then sevadar distribute it. But today, because of the limited number and I have the time available, I want to give it to you personally. Would you like that I give personally to you? I'll do that. Okay, I'll give you, each one of you personally, those who like to have the prasad can come one by one. Are you ready? Do you need any preparation?